Hi, everybody. Welcome and happy Sabbath. It is August 26, 2020. We're going to start out a call to worship today with God of our Fathers, whose almighty hand. Long as life endures,
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, have ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing. Shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. My chains are gone, I've been set free, my God, my Savior. By the blood never be the same. That's why I sing, all my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. There's a kind of thing that just breaks a man.
Imagine.
can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever. Forever worship you. I can only
everyone to a Sabbath in between the holy days. So when I tried to choose what I wanted to speak about today, you know, we're right in the middle of you know, some great weather. This weather is awesome. You know, it feels like the Feast of Tabernacles and the holy days are coming up. So, you know, last week we had the Feast of Trumpets. You know, Tom gave a great message on the return of Jesus Christ with the holy saints. You know, return to this earth, and he's coming on a war horse. We're coming to take over this world and set up God's government. Come Monday, we're going to have the Feast Day of Atonement, not a Feast of Atonement, Day of Atonement, where Satan is going to, the sins are finally going to be placed on his head, okay? The sins were never placed on Jesus Christ. He took the penalty for them, but the sins are going to be placed where they belong, and it is on Satan the devil, and it comes Monday. And, of course, we humble ourselves, you know, in that behalf. And then we have Feast of Trumpets, or the Feast of Tabernacles is coming up beginning next Sabbath. I don't know where everybody's going. We're going to Gatlinburg, Tennessee. And I think it's supposed to be like 38 degrees next week and some night. So it's going to really feel like the feast. And then, you know, we did the feast for 7 days, and then we have the eighth, the great last day. And I will say this, because it has nothing to do with my message, that the great last day, everybody's always said, we never know how much time that's going to be. Well, yeah, we do. What is God's timing? One day to God is what? 1,000 years. So if we believe there's 7,000 years of mankind, so the great last day's got to be 1,000 years. That's just my opinion. And that just shows that's the great white throne judgment, that how grateful and gracious God is to give those who have never heard or refused an opportunity at the end of time. So it's just a great thing. So I chose a message today called The Family of God, because that's what God is doing. He is calling a family. He is, from Adam and Eve, that was his progress all the way through time, is to try to create a family, those who love him as children of God. But I've done a subtitle to this, and it's Unity in the Body of Christ. Now, I'm going to cover some things today that it was laid on my heart, and we're going to go through this, and just please listen to the end. And I'm going to address some issues that happens within the body of Christ. What is the biblical definition and calling of unity? Yeshua, Jesus Christ, brought the eternal word and rebuked those who set aside the word to follow after the traditions of man, just like we find in Mark 7. So we'll compare Mark 7. Mark 7, 8 through 9 says, "You leave the commandments of God and hold to the tradition of men. And he said to them, 'You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition.'" And remember here a couple weeks ago, I did the unpardonable sin and what that means. Unpardonable sin is rejecting the word of God. The purpose of that teaching is showing how we should not be surprised of the sharp division that comes from those who wish to continue in the traditions of man when you choose to pursue the eternal word. However, noticing a trend that has been growing stronger and building momentum in the body of Messiah over the recent years. This trend is that of the willingness and heartfelt obligation to part ways from those who interpret the eternal word differently than themselves. And yet for some, it not always the interpretation of the word that brings division. For some people, it could be a topic that is completely silent in the scriptures. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not advocating someone who comes into a congregation with something strange and just way out there. But this is going to deal with topics that we kind of deal with most in all the congregations, the COGs and Messianic groups that we know of. If there is ever a time for unity in the body of Messiah, it's now more than ever. Yet now is the time that it seems to be crumbling all around us. Yet today, with those who are pursuing Torah, the opinion of it's my way or the highway. My brothers and sisters, I can tell you I've been there. It's been my way or the highway for so many years in the beginning. I carried my bat around, told you that before. If you didn't believe the way I believed, then get the crap out of my sight. I didn't want to be with you. And that's some of the attitudes that we see in the churches today. And it seems to overrule any and all differences of opinions. There are many points of division, like those of the name, how to say it, should we avoid the transliterations, the calendar, sliver, conjunction, or Hallel. Can the first month start before the equinox, or does it have to start after it? What translation should we use? Is there a hell? Is there really a lake of fire? And the ever-heated debate of the Trinity, which, by the way, has made its way into some COGs and certain things, and singular, all those type of things. It's obvious that someone must be right and someone must be wrong on these topics. Yet it seems that slandering others dishonors his name far more than them pronouncing it wrong or holding something in error. 1 Corinthians 13:9 through 12 says, "For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face, now I know in part that I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known." I wrote this in big letters. We know in part. This means that we do not know it all. And we have to make sure we understand this. We don't have it all yet. That doesn't mean change your mind, change what you believe in, but what I'm addressing today is how we deal with other people within COGs or whether it's other groups. And also, this message is for something that's come to our life, that's actually happened to us, and kind of what we believe and stand in. We all currently see but a poor reflection. But when Yeshua, Jesus Christ, he will make everything clear. But until then, we need one another all the more to help each other in the walk of pursuing the whole Word of God. And we must understand that it's okay that we differ here or there. In fact, it's only common that we differ on some things, and it should really be expected to disagree. If someone differs with us on how one should pursue a certain element of the Torah, we are not to be offended. Just be excited that they are pursuing the Torah and not rejecting it like so many others are indeed doing today. Now, I will tell you, between the guys who speak here, we don't always agree, believe it or not. But I think we agree on one thing, that we are pursuing each time we do everything up here to the best of our knowledge. And we do stand together that we won't allow certain things to creep in. There are some things you just can't allow. And that's just certain sins and certain things. And that's some stuff that we do stand together on. Do not condemn anyone for pursuing Torah different than we do. And pray that no one condemns you for pursuing Torah different than they are. Some are all too willing to separate fellowship and even look down or mock others who pursue the Father's holy days on different days from them. We've all experienced this in one way or the other. And I'm not saying that, you know, you can't have separate fellowships. You know, Paul and Barnabas had to go separate ways because they didn't agree. So there are ways, things that we can have separate fellowships, but it's how we deal with one another. It's how we are condemning each other or been condemned, you know, over these issues. To divide over or even declare curses on someone because they are remembering his holy days on a different calendar than you truly seems counterproductive to the purpose of the body of Messiah. I'm going to say this now, and then I'm going to repeat it here in a little bit. Be careful who you say is a sinner for what they're keeping. Better be careful, because you don't know it all either. We've just heard this recently. Be careful who you call a sinner for something that we think or they think that they're doing correct. Be very careful, because there's going to be something you're going to be held accountable for. Guarantee you that. We all have our stances on these topics as to what we believe is wrong or right. But if you believe your brother who has accepted that the Torah is truly for us to pursue today is indeed wrong on something, should you condemn them or pray for them? Should we blatantly rebuke them with intent to shame or prove wrong? Or should we ask the Father to reveal his way for all of us? None of us, and I mean none of us, are 100% accurate on anything. I personally believe that these things are difficult to work out because it could actually be revealing our heart. Tough sentence there. Could be revealing our heart. No one wants to be wrong. And when challenged, the first normal knee-jerk reaction is a prideful, "I'm not wrong." How many here, and I know we have a diverse group that's been here a very long time. We've been doing this a long time. How many of you have found out within this time that you've been wrong about something? Okay? And how many times did you probably think, well, they're a sinner because they're not doing what I'm believing? It's been in our heart, so it shows our pride. It shows that we are not always correct about something. Ultimately, what really matters is that we have a desire to keep his feast and keep them on the right days along with his Sabbaths. Our heart is to keep the Torah. That is our desire. This is the first and greatest accomplishment. Having the desire to obey all the Word of God, working it out into our action, is obviously the next. Yet if we keep bringing his appointed times down to silly arguments and vicious biting of each other, we have completely missed the point. That point is to walk humbly before our God. In James 1:21 says, "Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness," which is humbleness, "the implanted word which is able to save your souls." Micah 6:8 says, "He has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Humbly accept, not boastfully declare. Not pridefully point the finger, but humbly accept. Act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Walk humbly with your God, not boastfully, not pridefully, but rather humbly. If someone does not hold to the same view of the scriptures as you, that's okay. Walk humbly with your God. And let us not forget the first two, to act justly and love mercy. Is condemning someone or complaining about others for not holding to the exact same beliefs as you, acting justly or even loving mercifully? Hardly. Complaining about it to others will get you nowhere. In fact, if it's worth complaining over, it's worth far more praying over. Don't plant a root of bitterness in your fellow brothers and sisters by complaining to them about others. Take the matter to the Father. Complaining drives the mind to focus on the problem, and just as praying changes us more than it changes, praying drives us, minds us focused to the problem solver. And just as praying challenges us more than it changes our circumstances, so does complaining. So don't complain, don't grumble against, don't cut down, pray. In James 5, 13 through 16, says, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praises. If anyone among you is sick, let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the sick and the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Romans 12 and verse 3 says, for by the grace given to me, I say to you, everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of the faith that God has assigned. In Romans 12, 9 through 10, says, let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in show and honor. And then I posted this down here. Wisdom always leads to truth, while intelligence may be used to deceive. So it's wisdom that we're searching for. Philippians 2 and verse 3 says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Do we look at the body of Christ and do we put other needs and other people's feelings above our own? That is the family of God. That is what he wants in his family, those who put other people's needs above our own. Philippians 2, 13 through 16 says, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. So can we really cut others down if we are considering them better than ourselves? Can we really slander or try to humiliate someone if we are considering them better than ourselves? No. However, we can share with them our perspective of the scriptures and reason together. And if we still differ with them afterwards, we can agree to disagree and pray that the Father helps us all to learn and grow together. That's the way it should be handled. If others disagree with you, then pray. Do everything without complaining and arguing. All too often we have seen where disagreements arise and suddenly it becomes an issue of who is more spiritual than the other because their perspective is right and all of the others are wrong, to which we believe could have been the very issue that Paul addressed to the church at Corinth when he said in 1 Corinthians 11, 17-19, But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worst. For in the first place, when you come together to church, I hear that there are divisions among you. And I believe in part, for there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. Here are some slides I've made up, teachings that actually cause division. And you guys are going to recognize these. Here's first. You think the church has ever split over the Passover? You know, we used to keep it with another group, and just because we kept it the same days, but just because we called it something different than they did, they wouldn't meet with us. Now, how ridiculous is that? That was so ridiculous. It hadn't happened too many times, but it has happened. You think this has caused divisions in the church? Playing music, drums. You know, we were told one time drums are not allowed in church. And that's not just the Church of God's. That is actually in Protestant churches, okay? My cousin actually told me drums weren't allowed. And I told her to go tell her preacher. I sent a word for her to go tell her preacher. I don't think she did. I wished I could have talked to him, you know.
Guitars.
I told
him
guitars. No drums, no guitars.
You know what?
That kind of
Nobody
stuff.
Ever had a problem with piano.
I know, right? Yeah, all of us are just, you know. So, but I told her to go back and tell him, then take the book of Psalms, tear it out, take it out of his Bible, because he has no clue what he's talking about. What about this one? What is this? Women in church. Women ain't allowed to do anything in church. Well, I'll tell you what, the four of us stand together, and in this congregation, we believe it's not so, and we're going to let our women be involved, okay? That's the way it is. That's the way it's going to stay. And if we're ever wrong, he'll tell us we're wrong. But we don't see it as wrong. How about this? The sacred names. I love the Hebrew names. I absolutely love them. But if you tell me that I'm doing something sinning because I don't say a particular name, then we have nothing further to talk about. I was told one time when I had a back surgery back in 2014, I was told by a gentleman I was not healed because I was not anointed in a sacred name. Okay? I was told that. Of course, money. You know, money can sometimes get in the way. We know we have the prosperity gospel going all over the world now. This is some of the most ridiculous things to be arguments over is money. So, I'm not saying that we can't have disagreements and agreements. You know, we don't all have to agree. We can have disagreements. Now, there are things that, as leaders, we can't allow to come in. What I'm trying to present here is okay to have different congregations, but it's the way we love each other and the way we talk about each other. And like I said before, it's be very careful who you call a sinner because they do something different than you, okay? Matter of fact, we have something right there that says, don't judge someone just because they sin differently than you. It's a plaque that we have here. Is your attitude to prove yourself right, thus trying to prove that you have his approval? Are we to seek God's approval? Of course. It should be our desire to please him every moment of the day. But we don't see how slandering, defaming, or arguing with others who are pursuing the Torah differently could be pleasing to the Father either. The prophets of old preached repentance to those who have rejected the law, not to those who pursued it. It's one thing to reject it. It's a completely different situation to be pursuing it in error. Trust me on that. I covered that here in the unpardonable sin. There's things that we are not held accountable for if we do not know. If you believe a brother or sister is in error, reason with them. And regardless of the outcome, pray for them. Not belittling the fact that we should be pursuing the right way. That should be the desire in all of us. I simply want to bring out that there is a disagreement in how something should be obeyed the right way, that we should be willing to disagree out of love and at least rejoice that those who we disagree with are attempting to pursue the right way. And then pray that they keep searching the scriptures for clarity on the matter. And if I may add, pray that we keep an open heart, that we be willing to change our own perspectives if needed. 1 Corinthians 13:13. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love. Okay? You know, we can keep days and moons and different things, and it might be wrong, but if we don't have love, we are not got the Messiah within inside of us. It's just not there. And it reveals our heart. It's time to love. You don't have to accept someone else's views, but you can't reject them just because their views of pursuing the Father's ways are different than yours. At least they are pursuing His ways. If they are pursuing His ways and not the traditions of man, what grounds do you have for dividing? Just pursue differently on those matters and walk after the Father together as much as possible. You know, we were able to do that at one point in time. You know, it was another group here, and we disagreed on a lot of things, but the Sabbath we agreed on. So why not come together and be able to get together those things that we agree with and without causing contention? You know, it's always blown my mind. You know, and believe me, I was one of those that caused contention. But I'm not willing to do that anymore. The day will come when Yeshua, Jesus Christ, will arrive and straighten us all out. We all have something right, and we all have something wrong. And He will teach us all the correct way in every aspect. No one is required to change someone else's mind. All we can do is present what we believe and move on while being willing and open to change when presented the word in a rebuttal. Isaiah 1:18 says, "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool." Even the Father seeks to reason and not just set us straight. Yet he is clearly the only one in the right. So even here we see that He sets us an example in trying to work with others and not to dictate to others. Our heart's desire should be to please the Father and not just be right. And we need to pray for others to have that same desire. We have to get our hearts right first. Our hearts and not everyone else's. Once our heart is right before Him, we begin our journey of obedience, learning and growing with one another, humbly helping and humbly receiving help. So why divide? Can we not just differ? If one rejects the Torah, then the reasoning could be least be better understood. But because one pursues Torah differently on a few topics, where is the grounds for separation? Just keep pursuing and differ on these few topics. You know, we have a case to where, for the new folks that's here, Land Between the Lakes, a place that we've been, this would have been our fifth year. We were asked to come out to Kentucky to keep a feast of a feast that was dying. They were going to shut the feast site down. So we go out, and the feast site actually regenerated. And it was three or four groups, major groups, that got together to have it, plus the independents fell in. And it's become, first year was pretty tough, because, you know, people didn't like the drums, people didn't like this, people didn't, you know, whatever. So a few of those people did leave, but it grew to be a great feast site. A lot of love, a lot of understanding, and people just left some of the issues at the door. So it became a great place. And I'm going to miss it this year. In Psalms 133, beginning in verse 1, it says, "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore." Does it say agree in unity? No, it says to live in unity. What happened to the phrase agree to disagree? What are the odds of walking side by side with someone being in 100% agreement on everything in the scriptures? Have you ever met anyone like that? Did you agree on everything? I haven't. This will only happen when Yeshua, Jesus Christ, returns and sets us all straight. We all have different gifts, talents, and abilities. When we reject someone in the faith because they don't interpret the Torah the way we do, we are not only hurting them, we are hurting ourselves. We are neglecting so many opportunities of growing deeper in the faith when we reject a fellow brother or sister in the Lord for a disagreement that may not bear as much weight as we make it out to be. I can't help but think of the time when a teacher of the law came to Jesus Christ. In Luke 10:25-28, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' He said to him, 'What is written in the law? How do you read it?' And he answered, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' And he said, 'You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live.'" We are all pursuing the Torah. Can we not agree on that? Is there any of us correct on everything? The answer is no, not at all. We are all right on something, and we are all wrong on something. So let us pray for wisdom and insight and work together until Jesus Christ returns. It will be far more enjoyable for us all in this journey as we pursue His eternal word. Even if we celebrate certain days a little differently here or there, or view other elements of the Torah from a different perspective, we still truly need one another. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 14 through 19 says, "For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot shall say, 'Because I am not of the hand, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, 'Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of the hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as He chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, 'I have no need of you,' nor again the head to the feet, 'I have no need of you.' On the contrary, the parts of the body that seems to be weaker are indispensable. And on those parts of the body that we think less honorable, we bestow the greater honor, and our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, then all rejoice together. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping administrating in various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret it? But earnestly desire the higher gifts, and I will show you still a more excellent way." 1 Corinthians 13:1 says, "If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but I do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal." I wish they had Darla over right now to turn the volume up and clang it. That's what you sound like if you don't have love. May none of us ever reject someone in Messiah who is pursuing the Torah in obedience to the Great Shepherd with all their heart, because they pursue it differently on a few points than ourselves. We are all walking the same path. We are just at different levels, learning different things at different times. As Philippians 2 says, we are to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. May it be our heart's desire to pray for others to do the same. We are the body of Messiah. We need one another. Have we forgotten that love covers a multitude of sins? Are we not to love one another? So this is what I feel like that we need to build as we're growing this during these holy day times as the family of God. And as we go, some of us get going to the feast. We're going to the feast. I think we're going to have about 800 people at a spot. How they're getting by with it, I think it's a big facility. But we're looking forward to going back to Gatlinburg. That's kind of our stomping ground. We love that place up there. But within our own congregations, there's going to be people come in here that's going to have different views. And I'm not saying, crazy views. And I don't know what we decide would be a crazy view, okay? we're going to decide as four members here, as a board, what's going to be done from up here. That is our prerogative. You know, that's what we have to do. And if someone wants to teach something differently, they can start another congregation, the way I feel about it. But we can do it in love. We can love one another. Doesn't matter. Okay? So just think about these things and think about what our responsibility is to each other, how we're supposed to get along with each other, how we're supposed to love, and how we're supposed to deal with differences of opinions. So thank you very much.
What a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Thank you.
deploy. While fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sound in joy. I said repeat that sound in joy. Joy to the world, all the boys and girls. Joy to the fishes in the deep blue sea. Joy to you and me. No more let sins and sorrows grow. Infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow. For as the curse is found, for as well as the curse is found, joy to the world, all the boys and girls, joy to the fishes in the deep blue sea. See you.